February is Black History Month, a time to consider the role African Americans have played in making the United States one of the greatest nations on earth. Join us as Judge Belvin Perry Jr. and his sister Valeria Maxwell discuss what Black History Month means to them, the influences that help them achieve at a high level, and their journey as African Americans in modern America. Hello, I'm Diane Trees. This month, we take stock of the many contributions Black Americans have made to American society. With me now is Judge Belvin Perry Jr. and his sister, Valeria Maxwell. Judge Perry has enjoyed a long and distinguished legal career. Last year, he retired as Chief Judge of Florida's 9th Judicial Circuit and is now a member of the law firm Morgan & Morgan. Valeria Maxwell has been an educator for over 30 years. She's principal of Jones High School and was instrumental to helping build the school into a nationally recognized institution. Judge Perry, Ms. Maxwell, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's Black History Month in February. Can you share what that means to you, having grown up in Orlando?
Well, to me, it means a time of reflection. It means a time of taking stock on where we have been, review the great and rich history and heritage, and it's a roadmap of where we go in the future.
Ms. Maxwell, what are your thoughts?
It's reflection time, but it's also a time where you witnessed a lot of transformation that took place in Orlando. Growing up in this area and being a part of segregation and moving into where we are today, it just helps us to reflect on where we've come from, where we want to go, and the things that we don't want to repeat again. That's going to help us to continue to be the best that we can be.
So it's a work in progress then?
The work continues. We've come a long way, and we have a long way to go as a society.
Let's talk a little bit about your father. He was one of the first Black police officers in 1951 in Orlando. How would you describe your dad?
No nonsense, but always looked to find the best in everybody and every situation. And he always taught us to do likewise. You can't, sometimes you're not in charge of the hand that you're being dealt, but you play that hand the best way you can, and you grow and learn from it while you're in the process.
Judge Perry, what about you? How would you describe him?
Loving, a disciplinarian, a person who had a very positive outlook on life, a person who did not dwell on negative things, a person who always tried to find the best in everyone that he dealt with. He was a very positive individual.
That's amazing, considering his profession and the times to have that. It sounds like both of you loved him very much.
We all loved him a great deal. The one thing about my dad, he had this uncanny ability to calm down a situation and to soothe a situation with his demeanor and with a conversation with a person. He could take a person who was quite angry and calm that person down by just his presence and the way that he talked and he treated people. He always believed in treating people with dignity and respect, no matter what their station in life was.
What characteristics of his do you think that you've incorporated into your personality?
My father, being that he had military background, he was an only child.
Oh, he was, huh?
Yes, he was. I think that his mother required a lot of him, so he required a lot of us. He was very meticulous. He wanted things done in a certain way. He was very organized. And I think those are some of the traits that I inherited, which has really served to be a great positive for me as a leader of a school. Being organized, being focused, and being intentional about what you do is a necessity.
How about you?
Well, the organization I got from my dad, the discipline I got from my dad, the love I got from my dad and mom, but the one thing in our household, you were always taught to do the very best that you could, and you were expected to do the very best, and nothing less than perfection was accepted in our household.
So you had some strict strict rules to follow, it sounds like.
Yes, we did.
Yes, we did.
How much? Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No choices.
How much influence would you say your parents had on the outlook you have on life, your value systems? You had a lot of other factors, and you had other siblings too.
A lot, because my father taught us the value of almost everything. Because we were brought up with not necessarily a lot of material things, but love. And we had the necessities. The value of just life and things was part of the things that were just part of our household.
You and your siblings all have successful careers. Were your parents an influence in building that quest for success? Or do you think that that was just an instinctive thing or a product of the times that you were growing up in?
Well,
or is it competition with the siblings?
I can remember growing up, my dad particularly, and my mom, who was a school teacher, always stressed the value of education. They talked about college when I didn't even know what high school was.
Wow.
They talked about being prepared, and that the key to that door of success was to have an education. So there was no question that we were going to college, even when we didn't know what college was.
My dad was big on family, and every Sunday we were going to ride. And my father would take us some affluent areas and some not so affluent areas. And he would always stress that with an education, you know, the sky was the limit. You could do almost anything that you wanted to accomplish with an education. So it was a constant instillment, and going on that Sunday ride was a must.
That was a family time for you?
Yes.
Belvin Perry Sr. was a street cop in a time of enforced segregation. He did not have a high school diploma. Why was this so important for him? And he instilled that, obviously, in all of you.
Well, it's something my dad knew, and he would often say he had one regret, and that was not getting the education. And he was not going to let any of his children not have an education. He knew that the education was a key to success, and he wanted his kids to be successful.
He sounds like a formal education. He sounds like he was a very smart man, but without maybe the credentials to go behind it with that.
He was. He had to not finish high school because of circumstances. He had to help his mom. So he was a very intelligent man, and it was just to be, I guess, an extraordinary feat to see if he had had an education, what his life would have been like.
Right. Judge Perry, let's talk a little bit more about your background. What drew you to the legal profession to start with?
Well, I will never forget one day I had a doctor's appointment, and my dad took me to court with him because his court appointment was before my doctor's appointment. And I can remember sitting in that courtroom, seeing the judge come into that city courtroom, and I was just awestruck by it.
How old were you?
I was about maybe 7 or 8 years old. And it was during that time I said, you know, I would like to be a lawyer. There were two things that really interested me, science and the law. So I was torn between being a doctor and a lawyer. Analytical chemistry was a problem for me, so I said, I best be a lawyer.
You spent a number of years as a judge, and your peers have described you as a judge's judge, fair, consistent, but no nonsense. Things that I've heard you describe as your dad. Do you see those similarities come out?
Yes, I do. I mean, there's no question that myself and my siblings are a product of our environment. We are a product of our parents, and that's the way that our parents raised us. That's what they expected of us, and that's what we became.
You told me at one time that you loved being a judge, but the worst aspect was an isolation factor. You grew up in a segregated neighborhood. Isolation factors again. Why choose a profession that had those elements with it?
Well, there are different types of isolation. In segregation, you were isolated within the black community, and that's all you knew. Being a judge, you're sort of isolated in the legal community, but in the confines of being isolated among your peers, other judges. So isolation in some respects is not that bad, but it feels good now not to be so isolated.
Well, in talking about now, when I interviewed you 2 years ago, you told me that when I asked what was next, you said you wanted a more simple style of life. And I'm thinking golf and vacations, but here you are, full-time practice, personal injury, large law firm. Why go that route?
Well, it's not often in life you get a chance to live your dreams. And one of the things I always wanted to do when I first got out of law school, I wanted to practice personal injury law. But fate would have that I went to the prosecutor's office. I spent my first 11 years doing criminal law. And the opportunity came up for me to go to what I consider one of the best law firms in this nation. And it was an opportunity to fulfill one of my lifelong dreams.
Personal injury law. Well, you have an awesome background to go into that. We're going to take a short break. When we come back, we'll continue our discussion with Judge Perry and Principal Maxwell. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Talking with Judge Belvin Perry and his sister, Valeria Maxwell, principal of Jones High School in Orlando. Judge Perry, a lot of people associate you with the Casey Anthony trial, but what would you most like your legacy to be?
Well, I would like to be remembered as a judge that was fair, a judge that made a difference not only in the legal community, and a judge that made a difference in the community at large. I've been a staunch advocate of mental health issues, issues dealing with domestic violence, and issues dealing with substance abuse. I've also been an advocate for mentoring kids. So I would like to be remembered as someone who was a part of this community and someone who tried to make a difference.
Let's talk a little bit more about your background then, Ms. Maxwell. Your mom was a teacher.
Correct.
Did that influence your choice in professions?
Well, I was torn. I started out taking piano lessons. And so
master's is in music, isn't it?
It's in music, yes. And at first I wanted to be a concert pianist. But putting in all those hours in school and in graduate school, I decided I would go into teaching profession. So yes and no. I never dreamt that I was going to be in the teaching profession, but fate had it so that I took that route.
Well, and you've taken Jones High School, which has struggled academically, but you have successfully transitioned that into higher standards. What were some of the challenges that you faced to help that school?
I think one of the greatest challenges that was there was you had to really constantly instill in the students that they could do it, that they could be anything that they wanted to be. and accept no excuses. When they said they couldn't do it, you had to keep giving them that motivation that they needed, making sure that they had the things that they needed within the classroom, making sure that they attended tutoring. It was just, you had to be as persistent and relentless on them that they could do it and they will do it, so that they could wake up and all of a sudden they would say, wow, you know, I did it. So you just, persistence.
That's a sounds like a culture kind of change, which
yes.
is a very difficult and long range kind of thing to do. You've been successful in a short time. How has Jones High School progressed from an F school, a D school, now to B grade status? That's awesome.
Consistency, focused on what needs to be done within the classroom, and again, allowing no excuses, making sure that the teachers have what they need to be successful, and having a team to embrace the route, the vision in which you're going. And sometimes you take some lumps and some bruises along the way, but you just have to know, stand.
You talk about your team. I was reading about some partnerships. How important are partnerships or even mentorships? Because I know that you work with the children as well.
Yes. Partnerships and mentorships are awesome. Students need to be able to see other people that look like them, that are successful, for those people to really put their arms around them and show them that you can do it. Because of my experiences, the 100 Black Men have been very instrumental in working with the students, taking them on different educational field trips, and just surrounding the students with positiveness.
How helpful that must be for the students to see firsthand and have both of you as examples. I understand that the staff and faculty periodically tour some of the neighborhoods that zone students into Jones High School. Why? What's the purpose with this?
That's very important. The majority of the faculty do not live in the community. So you have to understand where the students come from to be able to help them to be successful in the classroom. Not that we're going to allow that to be an excuse, but it's very important. So yes, we load up a bus at the beginning of the school year and we take them to the different areas. And it's a very eye-opening experience because a lot of the members really did not understand from whence the students had come from.
You know, that sounds like when you were growing up, you said your Sunday excursions that your father took you to places. Do you think like sometimes that those things come back to you then and that those
yeah.
tenets?
Underlying things that you never think about, this, I guess, unconscionable things that are just so part of your culture and they come back up again,
and
yes.
some common sense kind of things. It would seem when you have teachers coming from different backgrounds too, they might not always realize, and for a culture change, that's a huge thing to
right.
try to.
And then you have to keep in consideration, a lot of your faculty may be transplants to the Orlando area.
That's
and yes. may not be familiar with some of the areas.
Yes. With the teachers who take these trips and that, do you get the positive feedback?
Oh, yes. The teachers usually have to write a reflection about the experiences. And I've had even teachers to say that they were really reluctant to go because they wanted to stay back in their classrooms and prepare for the students. But they thought that it was the best thing that they could have done, and they were glad that it was non-negotiable that they attended.
I love that non-negotiable. That's shades of your dad again, isn't
yeah.
it? How significant is Jones High School to the Black community?
Jones High School is that light on the hill that shines pretty brightly. With the graduates from Jones High School that have a long history of being successful, not only here in Orlando, but all across this great nation. Admiral David Brewer, Dr. Sylvester Gates at MIT, Dr. David Henson, who is the president of Alabama A&M, and another long list of individuals So it's that light that tells students, they did it, you can do it. They did it under adverse situation. You don't have that adversity that they had to face. And if they did it, you can do it. And that's why it's important to reflect the history. The history gives you the light for going in the future.
How do you see that significance?
Greatly. One of the things that I initiated coming to Jones High is what we call Cub Academy. We bring in our incoming ninth graders 2 weeks prior to school start. And during that time, the students are taught Jones High history because it's important that the students embrace the history of Jones High, because many of the students are unaware of the history of Jones High. And by them understanding that individuals have gone before them to pave the way is so important, and many students just don't know. Many people look at Jones High as being the beacon of the African American community because they know the pride and the values that have been instilled in Jones High over the years.
I have been reading more and more of the mentorships that are taking place. It sounds like that you're really building your partners and more help coming in. So hopefully that will bring more notoriety to the good things that are taking place. What would you like your legacy to be?
I would like my legacy to be that wherever I was, whatever I did, I left it better than it was when I leave.
That's very beautiful. Very good. Let me ask you both a question. Orlando, you've seen it's undergone a lot of changes, but what more should we be doing as a community to help increase those opportunities for African Americans and other minority populations?
Well, one of the things we need to do is more jobs, better paying jobs, more opportunities for businesses to start within the minority community, and more opportunities in terms of what I call outside education things, recreational opportunities within the community. I think if you have more jobs, more business opportunities, you will see the minority community grow and continue to prosper.
Possibly some more internship opportunities,
Internships
like that.
They are great.
Very good. Ms. Maxwell, what are your thoughts?
Just to piggyback off some of the things that he said, perhaps even with the students, provide more opportunities during the summer that the students could do internship. Even if they're involved in sports, that could be another extension, a way to have more partnerships, mentorships for the students. The students need to be totally engrossed in positiveness and to provide areas where parents can go as well to continually to get resources, whether it's educational resources, mental resources, whatever resources that are needed. We just need to start helping each other more.
Thank you both. It's been a pleasure talking with you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That's all the time we have today. Thank you for joining us on Metro Center Outlook. Until next time, I'm Diane Trees.